Hello everyone, and welcome to part 8 of my VR weapons tutorial. In today's video, we're going to continue with our sniper rifle. As we're shooting ranged targets, we really need to make use of our scope. To make our scope work, we are going to render a zoomed-in image and show that. Rendering an additional image in high resolution costs performance, and we're already strained in VR. Looking at the video that is displayed in the background, however, keeping in mind that our preview always shows only part of our buffer, we're never using more than a quarter of our screen for our scope. Also, in VR, everything is rendered in stereo. Godot doesn't yet offer the option to render viewports this way. Luckily, we're dealing with a scope that you generally look through with one eye, so it doesn't really matter that we don't render it in stereo. As you can see, I've dressed the rifle up a bit with some textures. I've left the scope alone so we can walk through all the parts that are needed. When we select our gun, we can see a heap of surfaces all repeating the same set of materials. I've left the materials on the mesh alone, as these will always be re-imported, and instead applied our materials on the mesh instance. This breakup of surfaces is something that is common with Kenny's assets due to the way these assets are constructed. It gives us the ability to selectively change the materials of parts of our guns, even if they share the same material by default. One thing to be aware of is that when we look at our surfaces under our mesh, Godot starts counting at 1, but our materials in our mesh instance start counting at 0. We'll start with making our blue glass transparent. I could render our scope image directly onto these, but this seems more fun. I always save these materials, so it is easier to edit them and apply them to the other surfaces. We'll turn transparent on, and then set our color. Now that our glass is transparent, we can see one huge problem. Our scope has no inside, and we can look straight through the sides. This is because by default, Godot tries to optimize what it renders, and only renders polygons that are facing the camera. Before we get to that, looking at the other side of our scope, we can see that our glass isn't transparent yet. We're also going to make that transparent, so we just assign our material here. Now we can create the material that we'll use for the scope, and all the other bits that use the same color. We'll assign a texture to it. I'm also using triplanar texturing, as we don't seem to have usable UVs on our asset. Let's quickly save our material before we forget. Before we configure the rest of the material, let's copy it to all the other surfaces that need it first. To get our material to render regardless of whether it is facing the camera, we simply disable the cull mode. Next, we assign our metallic texture. Here we need to keep in mind that by default, our metallic value is set to 0, so we need to increase that. After that, we assign our roughness texture. And finally, we apply our normal map. When we look at this end of the scope, we want to see our magnified view. But looking into the scope from the other end, we want to block our view. Let's do that first. We'll add a new mesh instance. We move that into position. And add a quad mesh to it, which we need to rotate. And size it so it nicely fits inside of our scope. We'll make a material for this, and increase its reflectiveness, and decrease the roughness. This gives a sort of mirror effect, especially when we have a proper background. I'm moving it back a little more and resizing it down slightly more. I'm not sure what I like better. Now we'll do the same on the other side. We'll create another mesh instance. We make sure we place it on equal height as our front-facing mesh. We also create a quad mesh and size it so it fits nicely. Now we move it into position. We'll add a material to this as well, but we're going to mark this as unshaded. As we'll display an image here rendered from our scene, it will already be lighted correctly. We also need to mark our material local to scene. This is required when using a viewport texture. Now we create a viewport and call that scope. We need to decide on a size for our viewport. Make this too small and our scope's image becomes pixelated. Make this too big and we just render a whole lot of pixels for nothing. Recalling back to our intro video, we saw that even when holding the scope close to our eyes, we were only using about a quarter of the screen. We're going to start with a resolution of 1024 by 1024, which probably is already larger than we need. We can always tweak this or offer a number of options in our game's quality settings. Making the resolution a power of 2 isn't as important as it once was, but it's still good practice. Now for the other settings. We'll keep HDR selected, but we do need to tick the Keep Linear checkbox. As we're rendering this into our final viewport, any color corrections will be applied at that stage. If we do this here, we double up. We also need to make sure VFlip is turned on. And finally, we set our update mode to always, or the viewport won't redraw. We will do something more there later. Now we can add our camera. This has to be a child of our viewport, to indicate that we're using this camera to render to our viewport. I'm moving this into position because we can see our visual guides this way, but as this is a child object of our viewport, our camera won't move with our sniper. We are going to use a node called Remote Transform to make sure our camera stays in position. We add this to our camera first so that it is positioned correctly. And then we drag it so it becomes a child of our pivot node. And finally, we assign our camera to our Remote Transform. With this set, the Remote Transform node will continuously update the position of the camera to match its global position. Let's configure our camera itself. We're going to lower the field of view of the camera to something very small. This will give us our magnification effect. We also need to update our far plane so we can see far enough into the distance. We turn current on to make sure our camera is used for our viewport. It shouldn't matter since this is the only camera. I'm moving our viewport at the top of our scene. I'm not 100% sure if this matters, but I've had better results when the viewport exists before the mesh that displays it. Now we go back to our mesh instance and select the material. Here we create a viewport texture for our albedo texture. And we select our viewport. We immediately see that our viewport is being displayed, though all we see is our background. Sorry, I forgot to maximize my window again. But we can see our scope is working. It isn't giving us any magnification, however. So our field of view is still set to high. So let's lower our field of view to 5. The other thing that I want to improve is that I only want the scope to be rendered when we've picked up our sniper. For this, we're going to extend our pickup and let go functions. I'm copying the definition of our pickup function from our base script into our sniper script. Now we call our original function first, so our existing action is still executed. We simply add a dot in the front of the function name. And then we change the update mode on our viewport to always. Now we copy the definition of our letGo function. We again call our original function by putting a dot in front of it. And then we set our update mode to disabled to stop rendering. We'll also change our starting update mode on our viewport to once, so we have an image at the beginning, but it's not updated when we're not interacting with our gun. I also want to be able to change our zoom level using the buttons on our controller. For this, we add a button function to our script. In our pickup function, we're going to connect to our button press signal on our controller. And then in our let go function, we're going to call disconnect with the exact same parameters. that needs to use our picked up variable that remembers which controller picked us up. And we thus need to make sure we execute this line before we run our original let go logic. And just for safety, we check if we were picked up. On the OpenVR plugin GitHub page, we can go to the Issues tab. And when we scroll down, we find a topic with our button mappings. And here we can see that we need to use buttons 1 and button 7. So, in our buttonPressed method, we first check if button 1 was pressed. If so, we increase our field of view on our camera, but I clamp the value between our minimum and maximum value. We do the same on button 7, but here we decrease our field of view. Testing this out, we can see that we can zoom our image in, and at its maximum zoom, we can even see our faraway target. You can see clearly that I'm having trouble holding the rifle steady and shake it a fair amount. That we'll look at in my next tutorial. For now, let's do one more thing for our scope. I'm changing the minimum field of view to 1 so we can zoom in a little more. But we want to be able to see what we're aiming at. Now, one nice thing in Godot is that we can seamlessly combine 3D and 2D rendering. We'll add a canvas layer to our viewport. We'll rename that to Scope UI and save that into its own scene. We'll add a color rect to our scene. We'll make it smaller and make it red. We'll position it in the middle of the viewport. Remember, our viewport was 1024 by 1024. I'm also adding a label so we can show our zoom level. We'll assign our custom font to this. We'll also make this red. Now we add a script to our scene. In here, we add a function that allows us to change the text on our label. Back in our sniper script, we can call this new function to tell it of our field of view change. Now it would be a good idea here to add an array so we can show the zoom level for a given field of view, but for now this will do. Turns out our font is actually too small, so before we test things out, let's quickly set up a larger version of our font. So we select our font from the menu at the top, and select Save As to make a copy. We select our new font and change its size to 96 points. I'm also making our target dot larger. We also need to fix this error by converting our value to a string. I'm converting it to an integer first so we don't get a bunch of zero decimals added in. Now we can see that when we zoom in, our text changes accordingly. And I can aim at my targets fairly well. The shakiness is a big issue, however. We can improve things by implementing two-handedness, which we will look at in the next tutorial video. Be sure to subscribe to my channel if you don't want to miss that. If you found the information in this video useful, a like would be greatly appreciated. If you want to support me more directly, please consider becoming one of my patrons on Patreon. And as always, please follow me on Twitter for more regular updates. I also announce when I do live streams through Twitter. Thank you for watching, until next time.